The Moral Animal by Robert Wright. Evolutionary psychology can seem harsh and uncomfortable. The logic of it might just strike some people as too Machiavellian to be a part of human nature. But to an evolutionary psychologist, its cunning ways actually adds to its credibility. And Huxley has a great quote about this. "The indecency of the process is to a certain extent in favor of its probability." The calculated ways in which we choose a suitable partner for ourselves, choose what child to prioritize in times of need, choose from whom we seek approval, it's all to further our own self-interest. Well, our genes' best interest. And we have become so good at hiding our true intentions that we don't even consciously know about it ourselves most of the time. Hi and welcome to the Book Lab. I'm Björn and this is the place where we bring you the best book recommendations when it comes to philosophy, psychology, human nature and human potential. And today we are talking about The Moral Animal by Will Wright. Why we are the way we are, the new science of evolutionary psychology. In the book, Robert Wright focuses on Darwinian explanations for why we are the way we are, both emotionally and morally. And he does this by examining the father of evolution, Charles Darwin himself. He examines his life and his conduct in Victorian England using Darwin's own theories. A society with very strict social norms and moral values. Robert Wright shines a light on the genetic strategies that governs everything from sexual preferences to office politics, and the answers that he provides are often provocative. One of those questions is, does monogamy actually serve women's best interest? The Darwinian view indicates that men, consciously or unconsciously, want as many sex-providing, child-producing machines as they could comfortably afford in their life, while women, on the other hand, consciously or unconsciously, want to maximize the amount of resources available to their children. Women are about quality over quantity, and this is because a woman can only give birth to a very limited amount of children within a lifetime. Women are the big winners in polygamy, and I found this quite surprising, but I have also haven't spent much time thinking about polygamy. Quote, "Obviously, women who are married to a poor man and would rather have half of a rich one aren't well served by the institution of monogamy. And obviously, the poor men that they would gladly desert wouldn't be well served by polygamy." This is not only true for the bottom of the income scale, quote. In sheerly Darwinian terms, most men are probably better off in a monogamous system and most women worse off, end quote. This thesis is only a thesis, but reality loosely fits it. In pre-industrial societies, extreme hierarchy goes hand in hand with extreme polygamy. In Sulu and Inca societies, men could have many women, and in most societies, present or in the recorded past that we have been able to study, polygamy is the default. So if polygamy is the standard, at least for people of high rank, then why do we see so little of it in modern society? One theory is that as political power became more evenly distributed throughout society, the hoarding of women became impractical. Quote, "Few things are more anxiety-inducing for an elite governing class than gobs of sex-starved and childless men with at least a modicum of political power." Of course, this idea is slightly outdated. Society doesn't work like this anymore. Women have their own careers, their own income, and are empowered in a totally different way. But I still found this chapter about monogamy super interesting. And looking at male and female relationship through the lens of evolutionary psychology is super fascinating. The book is full of these kind of surprising and thought-provoking answers to very interesting questions. What's the reason to learn about evolutionary psychology? I mean, we have left the primitive world, we have updated our morals, we have rid ourselves of most of the threats to our daily survival. Well, actually, that's the reason to learn about evolutionary psychology, because we are disconnected from our evolutionary past, but the programming of that past still operates within us. It's not correct to say that people's minds are designed to maximize their fitness. Fitness is in this case meaning to continue their genetic legacy. Quote, people's minds were designed to maximize fitness in the environment where those minds evolved, not in the current modern environment. Understanding evolutionary psychology will help you notice when your primitive programming is influencing your behavior or your decision making in a way that is not favorable for you, and it gives you a chance to override them. I will share three other great books about evolutionary psychology and human behavior in the end of this video that you really, really shouldn't miss. And speaking of great books, I also added a link in the description to my great books list. This is a list of all the best books that I've ever read in my whole reading journey. So check that one out. And while you're down there, like and subscribe and share this channel. It really helps me reach more people. And my mission in life is to enlighten people with great books. So thank you so much for doing that. One of the reasons that I read so much is because I try to figure out how to live in a world where the sole purpose of existence seems to be to put genes into the next generation. Sending genes into the future is not a problem in itself, but the fact that evolution doesn't care about our well-being at all, while we ceaselessly seek to put offspring into the world, is a hard pill to swallow for me. Also, our evolutionary programming is not updated for civilization, and especially not the information age. That's where books come in for me, because they can provide guidance for how to live a good life, how to avoid unnecessary suffering, how to be useful in society, despite the motivations of our genes. The same goes for books about evolutionary psychology. Knowing about nature's motives helps us stop and recognize when our evolutionary psychology leads us down a path that might have been beneficial in a hunter-gatherer society, but might not be now, when we live in an age of hyper-connection, social media, and on-demand everything. This might not only be the best book about evolution's motives for human behavior, but also the best biography of Darwin, because this book combines the two. It uses Darwin's insights about natural selection and uses them to analyze Darwin's own life and his conduct. And it does so in an entertaining way. This book is actually fairly accessible. It could have been very abstract, but Wright makes an effort to turn it into something that could actually be useful and practical. I really recommend The Moral Animal. It was a great book. And now I will share three other books that you really shouldn't miss if you're interested in human nature and human behavior. First out, we have Stumbling on Happiness by Daniel Gilbert. It focuses on how we fail to predict how the outcomes of our actions will make us feel in the future. We are not wired to predict the future accurately. Secondly, we have The Righteous Mind. It shines a light on the miracle that humans actually can cooperate with each other, and why we often fail to do so. The tagline of this book is Why Good People Are Divided by Politics and Religion, and this book ended up on the great books list. And last out, we have another Robert Wright book, Why Buddhism is True, The Science and Philosophy of Meditation and Enlightenment. It takes a scientific look at the teachings of the Buddha through a lens of evolutionary psychology and answers questions like, why do we give in to delusions? Why can't enough be enough? Why do we let our feelings run the show? You will find links to the full reviews of each of these great books in the description below. Next week, I'm back with a review of How to Win Friends and Influence People. So see you then. And until then, Björn out.